We are going to take a look at a lot of scripture tonight. I hope you have got your Bibles. If they're on your phone or the like, that's fine as well. I do wish that Bible apps on phones made an audible turning pages sound, because I miss that, actually. I'll tell people to turn, I hear nothing. And so I just assume we're not playing something to do with birds. I love the book of Revelation, but the fact is, that's the end of the story. I like to read thrillers, and I like to read mysteries, and I've got a problem with that, and that is that I read really, really, really quick. It's kind of a flash reading. Because of this, there are times in a book where as I turn the page, I put my hand on the bottom bit, because if I don't, I'm going to see it, and the other pages are not going to matter to me because I'm going to see what the payoff line is. When it comes to my life, I wish I could see the end. I know some of you don't. I've heard that all my life. People will say, if you could know how you were going to die, would you want to know? Yes. That way I wouldn't go there. Or if I did, I would kiss people goodbye, or if I was dying of a fatal, horrific disease, I have a list of people I'd like to kiss before I die. Of course I want to know that. I want to know the end of the story. But you and I don't live at the end of the story. All my life, people have come to me and asked me, don't you think we're living in the end of time? I don't care. Frank, I don't care when the world ends. I'm far more concerned about me ending. I don't think I'm going to see the world end. I think I'm going to miss it, unless we get a view from there. That would be nice. Maybe replay. But I'm more concerned about the end of me. Now think about Ezekiel. You know Ezekiel. That's that book you've never read but claim you have. Ranks right up there with Zechariah and Leviticus for making liars out of Christians. Ezekiel, well, and I can say this, I used to be a shrink. Ezekiel was a nut. He was insane, but he was God's nut. And God used him. God had tried normal preaching. Normal preaching didn't work. So he had a guy preach by digging a hole in the wall of his house and taking things in and out. By laying on this side for a while, then laying on that side for a while, and I guess that's 3 points in a poem. That's the sermon. A bit odd. But Ezekiel was us. I want you to think about this. Ezekiel came from a priestly family. Being a priest was all he ever wanted to do. Being a priest was all he wanted to be. That was his identity. And yet before he even finished his priestly training, he is yanked out of Jerusalem, where God lives, taken to the desert, where God doesn't live. We've got to work within his viewpoint here. Away from God, he cannot serve God, because you only serve God in the temple. That's where you do your sacrifices. That's where you do your prayers. That's where you do your incense. That's the center of God's life. It's where God lives, and that's gone. He's gone. He'll never be back. He is standing beside a drainage ditch in a refugee camp, and that's going to be the rest of his life. A stateless person. No rights, no privileges, no standing. Career gone. And the drainage ditch is ironically called a river, the River Chebar, but it's really a refugee swamp sewage ditch. And there, something happens. The sky begins to boil and head toward him. And when he tries to describe it, I love it, because he runs out of words really quick. And it's pointing that way. No, it's pointing this way. No, it's pointing all the ways. And it's like a lamb, an ox, an eagle. It's scary. There's flashes of light. And he keeps saying it's like unto, as, kind of. And he runs out of words. Right when you least expect it, he meets God. God has come to the refugee camp. That was not in the script. That was not what he was expecting in his story. But God is not there to tell him the end of the story yet. He's going to work him through a whole lot of stuff. I often wonder if Lewis Carroll, the great English writer, read Ezekiel before he wrote Alice in Wonderland. I really do. There's a scene there. Well, that sunk down, didn't it? You know why? Because I use a real Bible. It's heavy. Actually, it weighs more because the print is much larger. But that's there's a scene. Alice meets the White Queen, who informs Alice that her age is 101, 5 months and a day. I can't believe that, said Alice. Can't you? Said the Queen in a pitying tone. Try again. Draw a long breath. Shut your eyes. Alice laughed. There's no use trying, she said. One can't believe in possible things. I dare say you haven't had much practice, said the Queen. When I was your age, I always did it for a half hour a day. Why, sometimes I believed as many as 6 impossible things before breakfast. God's going to ask Ezekiel and you to believe some impossible things. We're in an interesting time in America, are you not? No matter whether you're happy with the findings of the Supreme Court or not, the fact is that we have learned that the Constitution is not quite what you thought it was. And you might be British after all. Ruled by whatever those your betters tell you the law is rather than what the law says. And it has scared a lot of Christians. And they're thinking, oh, what happens to us now? Well, you're not Ezekiel. Let's be very clear. They are broken. The people of God are scattered, disjointed. Some are in Egypt. That's where Jeremiah was taken. We don't know if he made it or not. Some are still in Jerusalem, left behind. Others are there in the refugee camp. Some just fled, and we don't know where they are, and we don't know where they went to, and we don't know what happened to them. Everything is confused. And then in chapter 36 of Ezekiel, God breaks into all of the judgments of dire, dark prophecies about what's going to happen to his people and tells Ezekiel that one day things are just going to be really great again. Really? And what would be your evidence for that, God? Ezekiel 36, verse 24, I will take you out of the nations. I will gather you from all the countries. Please remember that was a lot harder back then when there were no roads, no maps, no borders, no safe ways to travel. And we don't even know where everybody is. I'm going to gather you, bring you back into your own land. I'll sprinkle clean water on you. You will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from your idols. I will give you a new heart, put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to follow to keep my laws. Then you will live in the land I gave your ancestors. You will be my people and I will be your God. You would be excused for not believing this at this stage. Really? For how many of you have spent days and days worrying when there's the book of Revelation that says it's all going to be great at the end? There are a lot of times I wish I was Randy Harris because he comes up with really cool things to say. He says the book of Revelation is simply this. God has a team. Satan has a team. God's team wins. Pick a team. And I'm thinking, I wish I'd said that. So I need to go someplace they've never heard of him and claim I did. But until then, and he's on campus, I have to watch it. Until then, I have to admit that I'm very much like Ezekiel. I know God tells me I'm going to win, but it's not what my eyes see. I am limited to what I can see and feel. What about you? Some of you may have the gift of faith, and I've met people that do. We can all have a bit of that gift. I mean, I've met people who have the gift of faith, and they shame me. No matter what happens, they're just entirely optimistic. God's got this. They read the end of the story. And I'm going, that's really great, but that's in Revelation, and I'm trapped in Ezekiel. I'm by the river Chebar. I'm not by the river of life. Ezekiel's tried preaching to the people. That's not doing any good. He only sees with his eyes. And so God takes him to a place. The most famous chapter in all of Ezekiel. Not that that's saying much. Let's be honest. But it's famous because they wrote some songs about it. Is chapter 37. Sermons have been preached out of here. Funerals have been preached out of here. And of course, the slaves sang songs about it. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley, and it was full of bones. Please remember, that's what battlefields look like. Battlefields were open graveyards where the bodies rotted. Because you didn't bury, there was no place to put them. Nobody came to take them. Bones. You come upon a valley of bones. He led me back and forth among them. I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, son of man, that's just an expression in Hebrew. It just means guy, buddy, human person. Can these bones live? I replied, sovereign Lord, you alone know. Very diplomatic that, wasn't it? You know, hey, you're asking me? Then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Now, it seems incredibly nonsensical to pray to a bunch of dried up bones, but a lot of preachers know that feeling. So here he goes. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. Now, by the way, this is an impossible thing. What he's asking him to do is an impossible thing, is it not? You want to stand up here and preach to the graveyard? Remember, he had not seen the end of this story. I'll attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin, and I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise. A rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone, and I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain that they may live. And I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up, our hope is gone, we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says, my people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open up your graves and bring you up from them. Frankly, this is an impossible thing. And I don't think we do ourselves any favors when we act as if it isn't. This is an impossible thing. And not only is it impossible, it seems ludicrous of God to ask us to do it. I watched on Facebook this week. It's amazing how blessed we are and that that's not good for us. Really, being blessed is not good for you. You ever been to Africa? What do you remember most? I'll answer the question. The smiles. You remembered people smiling, had nothing, and they smiled. We have everything, and our microwave breaks, and we go, there is no God. We are spoiled. And so when we're in a valley of bones, we're looking about, and God says, preach to the bones, I'll take care of it. We say, I don't think so. Or we preach without faith. I'm saying we here. You notice that? I struggle with God too. I know there are people with the gift of faith. I don't have that. I have to work on it. You know, Jacob wrestled God once. I've got season tickets. I'm always saying, what is this again? So, to get this story down, I got to go 630 years into Ezekiel's future. That's unfair, because Ezekiel doesn't get to go there. But I do. I get a time travel by going to John chapter 11. John chapter 11. Now, you may wonder what the connection is. There's a connection. I don't know if my battery just went out. There it is. Maybe I moved about a bit. My ears grew. I was losing hearing myself. No, I've heard me, so it's no loss. But in John chapter 11, now a man named Lazarus was sick. There's a setup. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, in case you forgot verse 1, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. Back to the story. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is sick. When he heard this, Jesus said, the sickness will not end in death. Hang about. Did you read the rest? Have you ever read the rest of this? Maybe it was read to you and you had final graph figures, but you got the story. Lazarus dies, but it won't end there. Are you ready to believe an impossible thing? Are you ready to believe in an end of the story you've never seen? Well, let's keep going. No, it's for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now, this really gets to me, this next bit. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Now, friends, that does not make grammatical sense. He loved him so much, he did nothing. Now, don't think I'm being irreverent here. What I'm trying to do is get you to see this is more than a flannel graph figure story. These are real people, and something very impossible and strange is taking place here. And if you and I were there, we would have been very upset at anybody saying, I love you so much, I will not help you. Now, we do not run to the end of the story, because that's what we do, isn't it? Oh, no, he wasn't going to help him yet, but then he would stop it. We don't know that yet, do we? We don't. We're Lazarus laying in bed. Good news, he loves you. But he loves you so much, he wishes you the best of luck. He's staying a long way away. He said to his disciples, let us go back to Judah. The disciples warn him, a short while ago, the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you're going back. They were concerned about how their story was going to end. If you go back there, they're going to kill you. Death again. Death, 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 death. That's what we're worried about, isn't it? Of course we are. We're all worried about it. I'm going to have a little bit of eye surgery later. Nothing big. But a little bit of eye surgery. And the eye surgeon said, you know, while we're in there, while we're rooting around, we can do something down here to make the bags go away. I said, I earned those. I earned every, don't you dare touch those. I look in the mirror and I'm going, I don't know who that person is. Because I know this kid. I'm still waiting for the voice to change. We're a bit bitter about that, actually. And the whole eat your vegetables and you'll grow up big and strong thing. We actually had a visitor ask the family that brought them to Fourth Avenue this last 2 weeks ago. They couldn't wait. They called me. They said, we brought her and she really liked it, but she had a question. She said, who's that little guy up front? I didn't even ask who they were talking about. We are so concerned. How can God not be concerned that I'm having a bad day? How can God not be concerned that my kid's dying, I'm dying, my parents are dying, the court's not ruling the way I want it to, America, God's last hope. You know, if we don't do it for God, he loses. It's struggling. How do we? We're terrified. We live in fear because we don't know the end of the story. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours a day light? And anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble and they have no light. And of course, that means, what? Because he just said, all right, we're going to go now. And they said, but you can't go because if you go, they're going to kill you. And he goes, you know, it's best to keep busy. You know, people, quit trying to out-Christian Jesus. Let him tell his stories. And you're going to find out it's more human than you thought. It's going to hit you right where you are. I'm asked all the time, what do we do in this situation? Our church is this, my family is this, whatever. And my response is always, love God, love each other, stand up, face forward, and move. That's what you do. You don't die cowering, screaming under a bush. Move forward. Everybody's going to die anyway. Make it interesting. I already know what I want to say. My last thing I want to say. I hid the money. Anyway. Jesus tells the disciples, just keep busy, work with what you got. You know, we're worried about this, worried about, wait, we were told, love God, love each other. That should keep you busy. Well, what if this world's doing this and what if the world's, no, you got a job. Do your job. But you've got a job. Do your job. Have you ever thought about this? God working with us is like you living with 5 billion three-year-olds. They've got the attention span of a ferret on its third cup of espresso. And you have to get their attention. And you know what it's like, because they won't even make eye contact with you. They're going, and then you're going, hey, God has been doing that for thousands of years. He's been trying to get our attention, saying, do your job. Just do your job. He decides it's time to go see him. After he said this, he went on to tell him, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. That made no sense. No sense at all to them. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better. That was evidently medical care at the day. Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he had meant natural sleep. I love that about John. He often explains stuff I already knew. Then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. You know, he got frustrated with them after a while, going, I'm being poetic. You know, he's no longer with us. Where'd he go? He passed on. He graduated. You know, after a while, he's dead. Oh. And then he goes, and for your sake, I'm glad I wasn't there. You know, for my sake, I'd just like for him to be well. You see, and again, if you know the end of the story, none of this bothers you. But they didn't live at the end of the story. And we get this story to show us that we don't know the end of the story. Well, so that you may believe, but let us go to them. Thomas, also known as the twin, Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Now, by the way, Thomas's first name was not Doubting. Stop it. Thomas was brilliant. The only reason Thomas didn't believe that Jesus was raised from the dead was because they had sent him out for groceries when Jesus showed up. The others didn't believe it either until they saw him. When he saw Jesus, he was the first one to call the risen Lord, Lord and God. He's the first one here who says, I'll go die with him. The others, you almost see him going, okay. Because he's committed him. You know, I'll die for you, Jesus. And he turns and looks at us. Well, yeah, we were thinking that too. He was just quicker saying, I'm a mouthful. And I would, anyway. We're seeing with our eyes here. Look what happens once he gets there. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. Many Jews had come to Mary and Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. You can read into that what you wish. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Now, hang about. We say that to God too. Or if you don't, you need to. You need to be open with God. There are a lot of times last year, two of my best friends died of cancer, both of them younger than me. You think I didn't pray for these people? I prayed for them. Thousands of people prayed for them. They were great people of God. And the people died. And you think I didn't bring up to God? You could have stopped that. I don't know why that didn't get stopped. Now, I'm not mad at God. I'm confused. Because if I was God, the good people would be fine. Some of you wouldn't. Because I'm not as loving and as graceful and as wise as God. And so we're all glad I'm not God. Got that. The point is, don't you get confused sometimes over what God allows to happen? So does she. And she even then said, I'm not doubting you. Even now, I know God will give you whatever you ask. She wasn't saying, now I know he died, but I know that if you ask, you can bring him from the grave. That had not happened yet. She hadn't seen that. She wasn't expecting that. She was just saying, I still believe in you, but you've let me down. Don't you think other people in that refugee camp by the River Chebar had said that to God as well? You let me down, God. I believe in you. But you broke my heart. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day, which is exactly what we say. We do. Well, they died, but they're with Jesus now. And I believe it. But we often say that to dull our own pain. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And that is so hard to get. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she says, yes, Lord. And I wonder why she did. Because he put her in a really awkward place. People who believe in me live, he said to the woman whose brother is dead. Jesus will sometimes put you in a very difficult place. I look back over my life, and it looks like one big accident. Like I started falling down the stairs when I was 6 months old, and it hadn't stopped. Because I didn't plan any of this. And yet, God keeps looking at me going, you trust me yet? You trust me yet? And it's a struggle to believe in possible things. That's why we need the book of Revelation. We got to at least turn to the back of the book and see, does it come out all right eventually? Is this going to be okay? Well, she goes, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God who's come to come into the world. After she said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here. He's asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet entered the village. Why is he standing off? That's interesting. But was still at the place where Martha had met him. He didn't even move. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. That's a good supposition. So when Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and she said, guess what? Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. I've heard preachers when I was a boy say he wept at the lack of faith of the people. I don't buy that for a second. I believe he wept because he saw pain and he realized the lesson he was trying to teach them had required a friend to die. Does Jesus care? Oh, yes, he cares. But guess what? Some of the Jews said, see how he loved him. And others of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? This is our story. Is it not our story? If you're one of those people with the gift of faith, would you be patient with the other 99% of the world? Because we struggle with this. Well, you could have stopped it. You see, Ezekiel, Martha, and Mary are just like us. They only see with their eyes. That's all we see too. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor. He's been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you'll see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. By the way, he was asking them to break a law. The Old Testament law, and now you're unclean. You've opened up the tomb. He's a rabbi. He's an unclean rabbi. Jesus is going to show them that love and faith are going to trump law. Because they always do. They always do. So they took away the stone. Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Past tense. I knew this was planned. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out. You know, something, they didn't have exclamation points. They should have. They should have had a lot right there. And his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and cloth around his face, Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. And that's the end of that story. Really? Wow. The end of Lazarus' story wasn't yet. We have the same hope. The bones will live again. Lazarus will come out the grave. The devil has a big toolbox. He has a lot. And we think of the big ones, famine and rape and war. You know, the most effective tool the devil has is discouragement, disappointment. That'll do it. Every week I get emails, every week, at least one, from a minister who's quitting the ministry. Just stop. In our tribe, Churches of Christ, this is becoming a crisis. And so many of our churches are now so small they can't pay somebody full time. We're looking at ourselves thinking, are we turning into bones? What happens? We get disappointed. We're humans. We're limited by our senses. All we can believe sometimes is what we can see and feel based upon what's happened to us. And so the book of Ezekiel pulls back the curtain a little bit and says, look, God's at work. Even here, when you thought he was locked up in a box in Jerusalem, he's here. God's trying to show them something impossible. Back to Ezekiel 37. And I'll finish here on time. I've got five more minutes and I'll let you loose. They let me up late because they figured I can only do so much damage. Luke 37, verses 26 and forward. If I can actually turn a page. There we go. Must have been eating something sticky when I read this last. I will make a covenant of peace with them. It will be an everlasting covenant. I will establish them and increase their numbers. I will put my sanctuary among them forever. My dwelling place will be with them. I will be their God. They will be my people. Then the nations will know that I, the Lord, make Israel holy when my sanctuary is among them forever. Now think about that. And let's run 600 plus years into the future to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, what? Wait a minute, it's not December. We only read that in December. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby. Just another night with the sheep. The angel of the Lord appeared to them. The glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid." Good luck with that one, angel. Seriously. Angel shows up. Says, don't be afraid, too late. I bring you good news that'll cause great joy for all people. Remember Ezekiel 37. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. This will be assigned to you. You'll find a baby. Wait, a baby? Seriously, is that the way you would do this? The world is in trouble. Rome is just marched all over. The priesthood is a mess. The temple is incredibly messed up. The people are divided. Send in the baby. Are you ready to believe in possible things? Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace on those on whom his favor rests." Do you remember the apostles and disciples huddling and broken in locked rooms after the crucifixion of Jesus? They were fearful, torn up. They had lost their faith. To believe in anything at this stage was impossible. And then Jesus just walks in and asks them, "Why are you afraid?" Seriously? Because we hadn't gone to Bible school, we didn't know this story. Death's conquered, fear taken away. And in John 20, what does he do? Starting at verse 19, he says, "Peace," and he breathes on them. Do you remember Ezekiel 37? The breath will come. You will be healed. I don't know how your story ends. Don't know how my end. I might end tragically. I might end horribly. I might make horrible mistakes with my life like I have in the past and God not rescue me this time. I don't know. Don't know. But I'll end with this. When I was a boy, my dad would sometimes come around, a big old hairy arm would come around the wall and turn off the light. And I and my two sisters would all run, jump in one bed at that stage, because this is story time and it was terrifying. My dad would come in with the flashlight head under his chin, you know, ooh. And we go, ah. And he'd come in and he'd go, "Once upon a time, there was a wee boy and two wee girls." We're looking, that's us. Now, dad didn't read prepackaged stories. He made it up as he went along and they were terrifying. Your goosebumps would jump off your body, run around the room, and leap back on in random patterns. It was just a terrifying thing. But we knew, no matter what happened in the story, at the end of the story, we were going to win. Because we knew who was telling the story. Many years ago, I had a tumor. not malignant, anything like that, but it was in here. It had eaten up the sinus and some of the bone, and they had to go in and fix it. And I know some of you are saying, where's the scar? They cut around your mouth, they pull your face off to get to it. Seriously. And I'm thinking what you're thinking. They put this one back on. Anyway. So I'm laying on the gurney. You call them gurneys, right? The wee trolley, you know, the slippy slide to death, whatever it is. I'm laying there, and the nurse takes my blood pressure, and she frowns, and she takes it one more time, and she frowns. She starts to take it a third time. We have really low blood pressure. Very low. That's just in our family. So I said, is there a problem? She goes, do you know why your blood pressure would be 90 over 60? And I said, yeah, I'm all worked up right now. And she said, how can you be telling jokes at a time like this? Because we didn't know it was not malignant or anything then. We just didn't know. And I looked at her and I said, because I know who's telling this story. And no matter what happens, I win. But you have to be willing to believe in possible things. God bless. Cheers.